Yeah. Okay, I'm very happy to broadcasting is running, I guess.
Okay.
So I'm very happy to introduce to you Nasir Nawab. He's a professor of computer science at TU Munich, and he's also the founder of the computer-aided medical procedures laboratories at TU Munich and Johns Hopkins University. He's interested in patient and process-specific robotic imaging, medical augmented reality, and computer vision. So his group is very, very active and internationally very successful in this area. He's going to talk about robotics and augmented reality for patient and process-specific imaging visualization.
Thank you very much, Oliver, for the invitation and for giving me this opportunity to talk to you and your students. So basically, I looked at my presentation in your also the series of talk in 2011. And I think there is three slides overlapping between the two. So I'm happy that they are, even if I think probably your generation of students have changed, but still I think for you, there would be also a lot of new things that we have focused on in the last few years. I try to go fast because I have too many slides. Yeah, but eventually I can come back to some of them and discuss things. So let me start running the presentation, and please let me know if there's any problem so I can stop or I can restart the process. So do you see now my presentation? No, you don't see it, so I have to share it. And if there is any problem in, sorry. Okay, so I should be now sharing the screen, and do you see the screen now?
Yes, we see the slides.
Okay. So let me directly go to the motivation. So basically, and these things I go fast because you know well. So last century, there was a lot of imaging modalities that started by X-ray and changed the medical practice altogether. So in order to tell you a little bit more about our focus on interventional imaging, I just want to briefly go through the process. So when you go, any of us goes to pay to a doctor, so basically what happens is that the doctor would talk to us and do a bunch of examinations and also including imaging and create a virtual model of that patient in the mind of the doctor or also in the computer. And then they try to make a diagnostic. This has been established a lot in the last century and in the last few years, thanks to hundreds of millions of euros and altogether billions around the world. Process has been, also turned into virtual physiological human and everything. So the diagnostic imaging has gone very far. However, I want to talk to you a little bit about the difference between diagnostic imaging and interventional imaging. So in particular, when we talk about diagnostic, which means MR, CT, PET, SPECT, the process is the requirement of those kinds of imaging are very, very different than the requirement of an interventional image. So what you are seeing now is a regular acquisition of a preoperative imaging data in which basically, for example, speed is resolution. Speed is resolution of the image, and the process has basically a process which is done, for example, in an imaging center, and the requirement with all these devices were defined based on the requirement of diagnostic. They had to be general, they had to be easy to manipulate by technicians, and the doctor was observing the results of this imaging on the screen somewhere in his office. Now, if you come from that to an interventional scenario, this is an operating room in Munich 10 years ago, but today is also very similar in many places. Now the scenario suddenly changes. in the fact that now the imaging comes in within an environment of surgery, within a very complex environment where decision making is on the fly. And the whole requirement is changing. Now, if you look at what's happening in many places, is because the advances in the market and the scientific community, they are all on diagnostic imaging. Some solutions which comes up is I create a center with 20 million euro visualization or imaging devices, such as on one side MR on rolling in, CT rolling in, angio. And, there are different solutions sold by Siemens, GE, or Philips, where you have these multiple rooms. From my point of view, this is totally unrealistic. For research, it's very interesting, but this is totally unrealistic, and it's not actually correct, because those medical imaging devices were developed with the requirements which are not the requirements on interventional imaging. So not only they are too expensive, they are not optimized for those procedures. So basically now the diagnostic imaging and treatment, what happens is that very often when we were talking about augmented reality or when we were talking about navigation, we were talking about taking the preoperative data and superimpose it on interventional data. But that, again, is not the optimal solution, because, again, those images were not taken for interventional. And interventional, I am more interested in knowing what's going on dynamically in the dynamic scenarios of surgery. So the idea is we would like to have patient and therapy specific imaging. So imaging which would allow me to have interventional access to anatomical, functional, nuclear, molecular imaging. And for that, we want to look at some of the basic requirements of interventional imaging. So what are these requirements? One is preoperatively, when I do a diagnostic imaging, usually the doctor sends you and say, I need an upper abdominal CT. The objective is to have a general imaging, so allowing us for a diagnostic, for discovery. In interventional imaging, we know if you are on an operating table and the doctor does not know what the doctor is looking for, then you should not be on that operating table. So basically, imaging now has the major role of monitoring of something that you are expecting. So relevance becomes important. Then speed now inside operating room is no more resolution. Speed is life. I need to be fast because the doctor needs it for doing an action. And this action may take a few seconds or a few minutes. Therefore, it's not useful to take 20 minutes to make an image. Usually when we tell them that some imaging takes 3 minutes and you can use it after this acquisition, they are unhappy about those 3 minutes. Now you can imagine doing an MR or CT, which takes CT, which is fast, no, but takes you, doesn't give you the space, but MR or SPECT or PET, which take longer, is not really fitting the operating room if they are not adopted. Then is flexibility, because now we want to be able to, at each phase of the surgery and for different patients with different conditions, do different imaging. So we need flexibility, but at the same time, we need reproducibility. We need, it was easy to guarantee reproducibility in a gantry, which is completely fixed. But if I want to have reproducibility while having flexibility, speed, and relevance, then this becomes an issue. And of course, as usual for any medical device, and in particular inside operating room, I need reliability, usability, and safety. So these are the conditions, that minimum conditions or requirements that I need for an operating room. Now, talking about relevance, relevance inside operating room is very complex, because we have a surgical workflow. We have some target imaging devices, and we have human roles. So if you want from a computer science aspect to look at this and define solutions, including imaging and visualization, we need to first define the domain. And this domain now in a surgery room needs us to digitally model the workflow, digitally model the different devices that we have, which is easier because those devices usually we can represent them with different menus, different graphs of procedures or workflow. But the surgical workflow is probably the most complex one to recover. And then, of course, human task. And now, once we are able to represent each of these elements digitally, which once again, this for the part of the target devices can be done, the part of surgical workflow can only happen based on a lot of sensory and a lot of machine learning, where we could turn things which are happening in the mind of the surgeon and through training of 10 years to be digitally and statistically represented with graphical models. This is a community called, now they are calling it surgical data science analysis, is focusing on this. And then of course humans that have different role. And then the part we still need is the mapping between at which workflow, which target device gives me which information which could be used by which of the human roles. So of course I need, all this has to be defined digitally in order, for example, to augmented reality, to have any role inside the operating room. We need, you know, in that case, because of all those requirements, we need to automatically know in which phase, which information is required, how it should be displayed because of the properties of that phase, and to whom, who is the user, who can interact with this information. So this is a big piece of puzzles that need to be completed. Otherwise, all our fancy visualization or imaging will not be transferred inside the operating room. And this part is a huge scientific work, which if you are expecting companies to do it, they will not. They will prefer to give their target device and let people use it. But they are not going to take care of this modeling of surgical workflow and integration of advanced technology. That's, from my point of view, that's one of the reasons, in addition to the power of computation, that up to 10 years ago, we were not having many advances in interventional imaging and visualization compared to the diagnostic imaging and visualization. Now, we are talking about speed and flexibility. One good example is what we did with freehand SPECT or interventional SPECT. So I talk a little bit about SPECT. SPECT is an imaging which single photon emission computed tomography, which usually was taking between 15 and 30 minutes and such a device was used, and billions of images or events, statistical events of radioactivity was used to create this image. And of course, this for diagnostic, this is perfect. But interventionally, we could not do this. As you see the device, no surgeon can get into that device to do surgery. And it's also the time it takes and the setup is not acceptable. So a few years ago, that back in 2006, 2007, we came up together with our nuclear medicine department to move from that billions of events to about more than 40,000 events, but with a handheld tracked probe to be able to do a tomographic reconstruction, to do an SPECT, which we call it freehand SPECT. And this would allow us to have speed and flexibility. We combined a tracking system, a nuclear probe, a PC, and since I love augmented reality, we also integrated a camera into the tracking system. And then all together, thanks to a joint collaboration with nuclear medicine, we created a startup company at that time called Surgikai, which was allowing the intraoperative generation of such images. From my point of view, this is the first example of a 3D imaging device which was designed specifically based on the requirement of surgery. and therefore had the flexibility. Now, another requirement that we had, I will go back to that, you will see we will talk about that. Another requirement is reproducibility and reliability. There we looked at this pre-hand spec. So this was, this, you know, got the interesting point was because this was giving an intraoperative access to such valuable information. Very quickly, this intraoperative imaging got into the real practice. So hundreds and thousands of patients were actually scanned with such a device. And we started to look at how, so the user interface had two possibilities. Either they could show the nodules they were reconstructed on top of the patient in what we call augmented reality, but we did not call it like that for doctors. They just, it was an option of the user interface to have it augmented on the patient, or to have it in virtual reality where they could also see the distances and they could rotate and move around the virtual nodules that they had reconstructed. Now we started to analyze the reproducibility of that and looking based on the workflow to see how different surgeons were doing the reconstruction and whether there was a complete reproducibility of the system. So even the system, which was certified in Europe and FDA approved in US, was completely usable and of interest to the surgeon. The way they were approaching it was different. They had different surgeons based on their workflow and based on their expertise were using, for example, you know, the augmented reality view or the virtual reality view with differently in different phases. And then we started to look at these differences. This one was an ESMAR paper a few years ago. And they started to look at this, we started to look at this variation. We also look at some, you know, one of the things that was interesting for us was some of the surgeons were moving the probe with a reasonable speed, in particular in centers where nuclear medicine experts were there. And some of them were just impatient and going too fast. Even though if the reconstruction was acceptable and validated for their work, the reproducibility was not there at the level I am expecting to have that kind of reproducibility. So we went from, you know, an imaging which was diagnostic imaging with that, those requirements, to an imaging which was flexible, which was patient-specific, which was process-specific, because they would do different imaging at different phases and differently focused on different locations and different acquisition based on the particular disease of the patient and the sentinel lymph node they wanted to look at. However, we were lacking this reproducibility. And there, if you want to have flexibility and reproducibility, and a specificity to patient and process, we need to go to the robotic solution. Because that's the only way we can have reproducibility, but also flexibility and reliability. So this suddenly allows us to do a lot of interesting projects, a lot of interesting things that doctors could not do. Sorry about that. Do you see my presentation well now? Oh. Oliver, do you see my presentation?
Yes, we can see it. You were muted, but we can see it and hear you.
Okay. Perfect. So basically, we started to, you know, one of the things, for example, the robotic was enabling us was that when we wanted to guide the surgeon to make flexible imaging, we had a user interface telling the surgeons go here and there. But of course, you can't say the surgeon to take crazy you know, trajectories to optimize the time of acquisition and the quality of acquisition. Once you do it with a robot, then of course you can totally optimize your acquisition trajectory to get the best reconstruction in a fastest way. Maybe you want to mute again your microphone. So in this case, we went to these publications where we were looking at the mathematics of the, you know, algebraic reconstruction and trying to get the optimal trajectory online and patient specific go to the best, most optimized reconstruction. Of course, as soon as it's a robot, then I don't worry about the weight of the sensor. So we went from a 1D probe, which was easy for the doctor to handle, to a 2D camera, which was now up to 5 kilo, but for the robot, it was not a problem. So we could, in this sense, also reduce the time of reconstruction from about 3 to 5 minutes to less than 2 minutes. So we could go faster and get a better quality of the reconstruction with this robotic device. Then another thing that we could do with robotics was when, you know, in nuclear imaging, based on the time of injection of radioactive, you know, isotope and amount of radioactivity that you inject, and the time of image acquisition, whether it's 2 hours after injection or 4 hours after injection, based on the lifetime of the radioactive material, you need to change your speed to get the same reconstruction accuracy. This is very hard for a surgeon, maybe handled, can be handled by a nuclear medicine expert, more or less, but for a surgeon it's almost impossible. Of course, for a robotic device and our mathematical computational software, this was very easy. We just would enter the time of acquisition and how many becquerel was injected, and then the system would compute what is the statistical average time I need or speed I need to do the acquisition in order to get the same accuracy if I do after 2 hours, 4 hours, or 6 hours. So also when it's robotic, I can do a super calibration because I can run the robot with my calibration system hours at night and without getting tired and without getting and creating incredible lookup tables. So our precision also was dramatically improved and we could do really suddenly much better imaging. Now, all these advantages brought us together with Siemens, KUKA, to a smaller company, Infusion and Surgica, a few years ago to convince the Bayerische Forschungsstiftung to start a project on robotic imaging, having now multimodal robotics, ultrasound, X-ray, CT, all of them to work together inside operating room. From my point of view, I'm convinced that in 5 to 10 years, when we go to an operating room, we would have a small flexible robots, not as big as we have today, but a small flexible robots who would just come under the bed and do the imaging at the right time and disappear. And then the doctor can continue to do the work, but could get the advantage of multimodal imaging while the system is doing, you know, when he's doing or she's doing their surgery. So in this project, the first thing we started to do was robotic ultrasound. And this was one of the first examples with Christoph Hennersbergers and Bernard Furst to do the robotics acquisition. And now talking about reproducibility and reliability, one of the important components of this system is simulation and planning. Why? Because in fact, you know, if I have for every single patient a different trajectory, a different acquisition plan, then how can I certify that? And, instead of telling I always do the same, scanning through the same gantry, now I am telling for every single patient and every phase of the surgery, I'm going to do a different acquisition. How can I guarantee that I do the right thing? And fortunately for us, radiation therapy has been doing similar things for many years. They were doing different fractions of radiation and different scenarios for every single patient. So what they were doing, they were certifying that if my dosimetry software designs a radiation, my system can exactly reproduce that that radiation. Now, in order to be able to also validate our imaging, robotic imaging, we need to have platforms of simulation and planning, and we need to guarantee that once I want to do this imaging for this patient, my robotics or multi-modal robotic system can exactly do that. So we need to be able to take the virtual physiological human model, the planning, and do the planning of intraoperative based on simulation and visualization, based on diagnostic CT, CTA, MR, MRA, PET, MR, PET, CT, everything, and then make sure that we can reproduce those images and provide them interventionally during different phases. So this brings us to a lot of research work. You know, we need to do take the VPH, visual physiological human, and do define acquisition trajectory, acquisition speed. Need to do, take into account the attenuation, the acoustic window for ultrasound, acquisition parameters, and then also look at the fused data visualization. Now, from my point of view, what we are showing inside the operating room is a multimodal visualization of dynamic data, which means that in fact, what we need to optimize the whole process for is the final visualization. I'm more in favor of providing information, high-level molecular information to the doctor, rather than having a robot which does placement of needle or cutting, because as I always, believe so, is that, a surgeon who can cut well and suture well is a good butcher. But a surgeon who can make the right decision at the right moment is a good surgeon. Therefore, I give a lot of importance to give the right information, and that has to combine with the best, most relevant visualization of this complex data. So this is one of the softwares we develop and now is accepted for presentation in ICRA, is a planning based on preoperative data of ultrasound acquisition. So it's a very simple work, but it allows us to take the preoperative data and then plan an intraoperative scanning of the patient. In this case, we were using preoperative data of the same phantom, but it can be in fact an atlas of the patient on which I define what I need during the surgery and during the procedure before or during, and then the system would do that. And then we tested it on different experiments to show that this could actually transfer and do a planning of acquisition. But now one of the problems, which is really interesting for ultrasound, is actually the quality of the image. If you have been in an acquisition of ultrasound, you see that the doctors put gels and do a lot of handling of ultrasound to make sure that they have the best acoustic window. Can my robot do that? And the answer is basically yes. I will show you later. These are some experiments for spine where we can actually do a really beautiful tomographic reconstruction of ultrasound. We can see that the results are in water, of course, but also we did it now in volunteers. And you can see that the results are quite amazing and can be now with advanced visualization can bring us to a lot of nice planning or action. Now, one of the things I was talking about is optimization of the, of the image. Sorry, I mute my computer. I hope you still hear me. So basically what we are doing here is that we are computing what is what we call a confidence map. So the confidence map is a concept we developed a few years ago and published in MedIA with one of my PhD students, Karamalis, and Athanasius Karamalis, where we use random walk to compute the probability of an acoustic wave getting to the sensor from the from each part, each pixel, each voxel on the image. And then we are visualizing it. Now, the doctor says, this is my area of interest, and I want this to be of the best quality in terms of acoustic window. And the robotic is moving and adjusting its visualization to guarantee the good quality of the image in the acquisition window. This is also now accepted in ICRA. The first one was 2015, and the second work is in 2016. Now, how does this process will now look? We will have the diagnostic process model. We'll get a patient model, which is a virtual physiological human. We have a surgical process model. We do simulation of intraoperative imaging based on preoperative imaging. And then we compute the inverse kinematic of robotic imaging acquisition to do the robotic acquisition planning. And then intraoperatively, we get dynamic images. We then update our acquisition plan based on these deformations. And then we do multimodal registration-free image acquisition. By registration-free, we mean that the robots are kissing each other. So the ultrasound robot, the gamma robot, the X-ray robot, they all work in the same space. So we don't need to do any kind of registration anymore. Now, in this case, usability and safety becomes important. One of our one of the doctors who work very closely with angiography in Dr. Stroter in Wisconsin told me that usually the companies come and show him such images, but in reality, this is his operating room, interventional room. So it's not like that, it's like this. And he was telling that usually when they show me their user interface, it looks sexy for an engineer, it looks very fancy. And then they show me things, but inside interventional room, these things bring me crazy, because there are too many buttons, too many options, and I have to do my intervention. I'm not there to get the best visualization. I want to do my injection, I want to monitor the patient. I don't want to be dealing with all these parameters and joysticks and et cetera. So what happens if I have now four robots? Do I need four joysticks? Do I need to control all of them? The answer is no. Our objective is what we call desired view control, which means again with the visualization, within the planning, the doctor should say which image I want to have and not anything else, or which multimodal image I would like to have at this moment of surgery. And we are the ones who have to compute the inverse kinematic. We did some example of it, which was published in Mikai 2 years ago, where with our angiographic partners, we gave them an iPad, and the doctor could move his CT, and we were simulating the X-ray. And as the view was generated, we were computing the inverse kinematic that we need to move the C-arm with to get the view, the desired view. And the doctor could drop that desired view onto these menus down there and says, in the first phase, I need this view. In the second phase, I need this view, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And this would allow them what we call desired view control. Now, this is only with X-ray, but we need much more. We need to do that. This is another example with MR. So we define a slice of ultrasound that we are interested in the MR image. And then the system goes, thanks to Kinect, thanks to a volumetric acquisition on the patient of ultrasound, the system then does a deformable registration between ultrasound and MR, and then computes now the positioning based on this information and the Kinect and the surface to get the desired view of ultrasound that the doctor looked, for example, found the nodule in liver and now wants with ultrasound to monitor the injection of a needle while doing that. So we call it desired view, And again, now you start to see how visualization would be the essence of our inverse kinematic and our control. Now, this one, which was recently published in this year, Mikai, is a collaborative work between a gamma camera robot and a doctor doing ultrasound. So the idea is that the doctor does the ultrasound and look at the nodules, but at the same time, the gamma camera is like a dog following the doctor to make sure that it's looking orthogonally to the beam mode taken by the doctor, so the doctor can see at the same time both the nuclear information and the ultrasound information. And then the doctor can take, my hope is that both of those robots would be ultrasound, would be robotic, robotically controlled, and the doctor would have his hands free or her hands free to do the injection of the needle or doing its biopsy. So again, my hope is that this visualization would be defining the whole process. Now, safety is also important. So of course, we have to visualize and simulate all aspects of collision and et cetera. However, one aspect which is in imaging is important is radiation. And now again, we believe that now with the 3D technology and simulation of radiation, we can reduce the risk a lot. So in this work that we published in ISMAR, sensors are attached to the C-arm, and we use the model of radiation from Siemens, which provided the C-arm. So, and then we use the simulation of GENT from CERN. So the idea is that as soon as you want to take an X-ray, you push a button, the system shows the radiation amount on different parts of your body and the patient's body and says, is this okay? And then if you push the OK button, then the system continues to do the acquisition. Or this is a C-arm based, Nicola Padoy did a room based with many sensors that could at all times show this. So this could bring visualization into the heart of the system. Now, finally, I want to go back in the last, hopefully 7 minutes of talk, a little bit more focus on AR, because I know that you're very interested in visualization. So in the last, few decades, the augmented reality in medicine probably started with works or ideas of Henry Fuchs back in 1902, 1993, and many others, but in particular, Henry and Andrea Stadte and others, where they were trying to do augmentation of ultrasound with head-mounted display, this beautiful scenario. But at that time, the computational power was ridiculous, and it was not possible to do a good work because of that. And tracking and synchronization also was not at the level. Then later on in 95, 96, Eddie Edwards and David Hawkes at King's College London, together with Zeiss, they integrated augmented reality into microscopes. But then again, two of the problems they had was depth perception, because the doctors were telling, we don't like these blue vessels on top of the things. We can't perceive this location. It's bothering us during the action, even though it was fascinating technology, and therefore they couldn't integrate it into the workflow. So they stopped, they bent to the patient even in 96, which is really early, for going to real surgery with augmented reality, but they could not continue that. And one of the major issues was depth perception. Kikinis and others also in 96 in MIT and Harvard, they did some augmentation from an external camera. Again, depth perception and workflow integration was probably some of the major issues. DiGioia and others in 98, they started to do tracking with the window AR back in 98. And again, some of the problem was there was many components. You had the display, the semi-transparent display, they had to track the head of the surgeon, they had to track the patient, they had to track the tool. And this tracking was too cumbersome and to calibrate and co-calibrate. And when something was going wrong, they had to recalibrate. It was taking about 20 minutes to recalibrate the whole system. and therefore workflow integration did not succeed. Some people in Germany in particular, a company called Medarco out of Fraunhofer, and a doctor, a surgeon called Seidhofer, they tried to use similar system like ARCs or Medarco system, but they all got to these similar problems. But it was one more step towards the right thing. Bitferner et al. In Akaha, Vienna, they did, this varioscope, and they were able to bring preoperative data in. Again, they had a lot of problem with tracking and workflow integration. So in all, they realized the dream more or less, they realized the first part of the dream of Fuchs and others, because that by the end of the 1990s and early 2000, they had the good power of computation. They still had problem of depth perception and workflow integration. We worked with them, and during the last 10 years, the early 2006-2007, we tried to bring some of the technology that was developed, ideas of developed on VR in SIGGRAPH into AR, and we did focus of attention. We did also the ghost viewing, combining the high curvatures and focus of attention, and also the computation of the angle of the viewing to improve the perception. There have been many work also by Imperial College London in also in other groups in improving the perception. So I think we are quite far in perceptual visualization in AR. In terms of integration into the workflow, we also started to integrate into the workflow. This was, some of you are aware of camera augmented mobile C-arm. So we brought it to 40 surgeries, and we could actually nicely integrate it into the workflow, in addition to the freehand spec that I already showed you. This is the work I showed you with freehand spec and gamma and ultrasound. This was also went to the patients and provide an augmented reality view inside the real scenario. You could see fused data. So I believe that we got past the computational power issue. We have advanced tracking, perceptual visualization, even workflow integration. But something that we were not, when we went to clinical validation finally, we found out all of these things are very important. But even if after solving all this, what we are still missing is what I call relevance-based data fusion. Just putting things on top of each other doesn't make it useful. We need to have, every pixel has to decide what are the relevance information at this pixel or voxel to be exposed. And therefore, that relevance means, for me, means machine learning. We need to start do machine learning with this to have augmented reality, which is relevant. A very, very simple first work we did was with our X-ray plus optic camera augmented mobile C-arm scenario. We started to ask doctors, show them the augmentation and tell them, can you collect and tell me at each point, which information is important? And we started to do, at that time, random forest, and then trying to decide on each pixel which element I am observing and what is the priority of that element. And suddenly we went from a visualization here, which was our simple augmentation of X-ray with optics, to a much more interesting, much more complex augmentation, where at each pixel we decide which blending I need. Do I need at this point, like here, a 50% blending of each? Do I need a complement optics? Do I need a complete optics? Or at some point, maybe I need complete X-ray. So what do I need to complain? Now, this was a simple case. We did it, and the doctors suddenly were much more interested in the data. But there are more complex scenarios, such as, for example, IVUS OCT. What if I have IVUS and OCD, how do I fuse that? Do I just put them on top of each other? Then I can cover some of the information I have in ultrasound based on OCT and vice versa. So we started to look whether we can learn how to fuse that. And one of the, you know, blockage in medical visualization was when I was talking to some expert of visualization in different SIGGRAPH communities, one of the complaints they had about medical was we are depending on segmentation, on filtering, on registration. So we are not, we can't do our visualization freely. So we started to work on a concept with Christian Schulte-Zumberg, where we call it predicate-based visualization, where we start taking advantage of those, you know, processing such as segmentation, filtering, all this information, even classification of each pixel to improve the visualization. So the idea is that the doctor either tells us by just scribbling, telling this is, you know, the area of interest. So for each voxel, we are computing a set of predicates. It can be probability of being belonging to a vessel. It could be gradient of magnitude of gradient. It could be a segment, a classification, a statistics on the classification of probability of belonging to a vessel or belonging to a skin, and then. First, there are two options. Either the doctor can scribble and say, these are the area of interest. And then we look at those voxels and see which parameters we should fix to enhance those area. Or the doctor can directly play around with these predicates and get an optimal visualization. Now, of course, what I'm showing here is unimodal. It's only 3D in ultrasound, which is a complex system to visualize. Now, in this case, the doctor is interested more in vessels. But you can imagine I can do this on multi-modal. And in addition, I can let the doctor optimize his view or her view and then gradually do a machine learning in the background and to find out for each phase and each application, what are the combinations they are most interested to see. So these are the directions that we are taking. Those robotics were some of the applications, most recent applications we saw. I usually have disclaimers to say it may not be a perfect wheel, but it's a state of art wheel that you're hoping to present. And before finishing, I would like to thank many generation of students here. These are the old generation, the new generation, and the John Hopkins partner, part of our lab, because everything I showed you are those. You can see a lot of, you know, videos. There were also some BBC report recently that you can see directly on our website. Many different papers and videos. I did not show many of the things which are just out of acceptance in this presentation. You can find all of them on our website. And I thank you again, and I'm here for any question you have. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nasir. It was a very interesting talk. Oliver, unfortunately, already left, so I will take over now the moderation. And, he's open for questions. Are there any questions? Okay, well, usually the moderator has to start with the question, so I have a couple.
Sure.
First of all, the first one is actually related to this handheld spec that you showed in the beginning. Do you have some kind of user guidance in this process so that you show the user where to move next? Does this actually?
So usually, you know, in the version which is commercialized, we do have. Let me stop sharing the screen so I can see you, or you can see me rather. Okay. So basically, in the product which came out and got certified, we needed to provide guidance. And those guidance are basically showing the doctor as the doctor is moving. You know, if you want, you can't ask the doctor to do crazy movements. They will not do. So what the system was only making sure when we were doing it handheld is that we have enough information to do the reconstruction. So usually, we were guiding the doctor to cover the whole space of interest. So the doctor would move and the system would show based on computation on the measurement matrix, which areas of the 3D are covered and which viewer are still needed. But we will not ask them to, you know, optimize. We will tell them cover systematically the whole area. And therefore, that would take them about 3 minutes, originally five, at the end, two to three minutes to cover the whole space. Of course, if I do it robotically, then I go one direction, and then I can go orthogonally, and I can then go in a different direction, so I can do crazy movements. You can't guide a doctor to do that. You know, it's not reasonable to ask a surgeon to do crazy trajectories. So we were showing him in the AR, on the top of the patient, which trajectory they have to follow, which was usually a regular grid of complete acquisition. Yes.
Okay, thanks. Are there any questions in the meantime? Okay, Holger.
Yeah. I have one question regarding the augmented reality. You showed the related work of other groups, and they were mainly using either some head-up mounted head-mounted display, or some you showed some with a display, and in the last thing, in the last book, I think it was your work where you had the degree of interest one. How is the X-ray projected on the skin of the patient, or is it how do you see it? Is it the same head-mounted display, or how does it work?
No, that went very quickly to real surgery because it was easily integrated into the surgery. So since I had presented it a few years ago, I did not include it here, but now I can share with you a few slides to show you how it actually works. So let me show you quickly. Let me share again the screen. Share the screen. Okay, let me now run the presentation. So that concept was something that I developed back in 1998, 1999. The first idea was occurring to me because I was working on mobile CRM and calibration of them with an attached camera. While I went to I went to mixed reality conference in Yokohama, where they had a lot of head-mounted display, where they were aligning a side camera back in 1999 with the regular view of the user tags to a double mirror system or prisms. So when I came back, I decided that I can replace the eye of the user with X-ray, and therefore I can create this scenario where at all times the camera sees the same thing as X-ray. So this scenario was built up very easily at that time, and then we started to create a possibility of taking X-ray and optics at the same time. Of course, the advantage is reduction of enormous amount of X-ray, because what you do is that you take an X-ray from this view, then the X-ray is stopped. So the X-ray is stopped, but when you bring your hand, you can see your hand in the same view, exactly the same view as the X-ray. So therefore, instead of looking at an X-ray and imagining where to cut, you can look at the screen. This is not a head-mounted display. You're looking at the screen of the X-ray system, but you can bring your hand in and start cutting. So the advantage of workflow integration was we were not changing anything. It was the same display, but next to the X-ray, we had a system of augmented reality where they could bring their hand actively and look at the augmentation of the system. So this is the scenario. So you had the regular X-ray and you had the augmentation that you could see in reality. And then suddenly you could have scenarios where this was, you know, you can take the patient, prepare his hand, for example, and once you are ready, you see exactly where the X-ray comes, so you don't get it on your hand. But as soon as you take the X-ray, then you fix the X-ray, and now you can bring your hand in and you can start manipulating on without getting X-ray. Or we showed in some of our TMI papers in 2012 that the number of X-ray can be reduced from 14 to 18 to 2, 1 or 2, and those are also for beginning for starting and for the end for validation. Unless if you're moving enormously the patient, in that case, we put optical X-ray markers to show the doctor that he is making the X-ray invalid by moving. When it becomes red, means that the original X-ray is invalid. And they either need to bring the patient back to a valid X-ray or take another X-ray. Mm-hmm. I hope this answers your question.
Yeah, thank you very much.
No problem.
One more question regarding the workflow at the end. So you said that the main problem or the things that the issues that you have to solve now is the validation, the clinical validation of the workflow that you solved already. And do you have can you guess or can you say when this might happen? So will it happen in the next 2, 3, 5?
I mean, I think it would be, there is a lot of movement in that direction. So we did it only for a few cases. We did it for our orthopedic surgeries. We tried to define the workflow and analyze it statistically. We also tried to do with Professor Feusner and a lot of sensors. We tried to do the cholecystectomy. But around the world, now there is a big movement. So there in Heidelberg, actually in right before IPCAI this year on 22nd and 23rd or 20 and 21st of June in Heidelberg, there is a full workshop on data, surgical data science. And there are groups like us, but also like Heidelberg or like the people who were working on this for a while, were Heinz Lemke or Pierre Janin. Recently, also in Johns Hopkins, you have Greg Hager in Imperial College. You have Guang Zhongyong. You have Thomas Neumuth, Borkert. You have many people now. They are focusing on finding ways to get a lot of data. Also, Nicola Padoy in Strasbourg to get a lot of data from record a lot of data in surgeries. And then try to do machine learning and try to learn first a statistical representation of signals presenting a surgery, and then being able to do prediction. Actually, Intuitive now is also providing a lot of data to people to do study and analysis. I would say it would take at least another 5 years. Mm-hmm. But I think you're at the height of the research, and there is also some more. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
No problem.
Okay, I think we have time for one more quick question.
Sorry, I just have to close all this. And let me go. Do you? Oh, yeah, I'm still sharing. No. Good. If you have any question, you can also send me email, or you are welcome to visit our lab in Munich or in Johns Hopkins. But you also feel free to contact us on our website. There is a lot of information you can go through. But I would love to also have you visit our hospital labs in Munich or our lab whenever it's possible for you.
Okay, sounds good. Yeah. And then let's thank the speaker again. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And I hope to see you soon. Sure. Bye-bye.